Good morning and welcome to Pendray Station. I'm joined by my good friend and mentor, Mr. Smith. Apologies for not being on the screen for a while, but we've been doing lots of things in the background. We've got lots to talk about today, and we have been doing some Christmassy stuff that you might see later in the month. What are we talking about today, Smith?
The things that have been going on at Pendray, the work that we've been carrying out in our secret little sheds, which we can open up through the medium of film. How's that?
What a load of rubbish.
Right. Okay. We're going to show you what we've been doing.
Yeah, fine. Okay, so we've got a new tamper.
Yep.
We've got new fitters.
We've got two new fitters.
We've got old guys. Locos.
We've got a diesel loco. We can show you the work we've been doing on it. Steamer loco number 3's had some work. Loco 2's under overhaul. We're repairing and making new screw couplings. And we've got an ash wagon under repair and repaint. And then if we go over the paint shop, we can see the new open being built. And there's also the tamper as well, tamper machine. There's quite a bit this time.
How exciting.
Thrilling.
Let's crack on.
Okay.
Okay. Well, we do, the engineering department do have a certain penchant for yellow machines.
That's a big word for you.
And this is a yellow machine. The last time we saw this yellow machine, it was in bits because Chris ordered this lovely new tamper from China, and then the first thing he had to do was cut it up. So it's now back together, and you may notice there's some different colours here with some very nice welding, which wasn't done by Chris because it's no spatter on it. And we've said that before.
But this
is now in use. This has been commissioned, yep. It's been used, and we'll be seeing some footage of that later. We might actually have it out and play with it now. But the big reveal is, Chris, that if you remember, when we did the fundraising for this, and it was fully funded by members' donations and goodwill and everything else, it's really, thank you very much for that, we said we'd like a name for it. And we can now reveal, as you can see from this fantastic luxury curtain that's across it, we have a name. And Chris, would you like to do the name? And I'll do the drum roll.
Go on then. It's called Idris.
Idris is the name of the tamper, and that's sort of very fitting because we are in the foothills of Cader Idris, and as many rail enthusiasts will know from their youth, Idris was also the dragon in Eivor the Engine. So it's got two connotations, and it was also nice and short for Chris to make because this is now printed by his own fair hand on his little 3D laser printer thingy-majig. How do you make it?
It's a 3D printer, that's all.
Okay. Do you want to quickly run through
what
you've done to this thing to make it worthwhile?
Well, we imported it from China, and we gave them a drawing of our loading gauge, which is how big the railway is, and it came back, and unfortunately it was not quite the right size, and it was a bit wide and a bit low. So Martin Turner has altered the framing, and well, rebuilt the framing, really, so it does now actually fit up the railway. We found out from the Puff and Billy Railway that their Chinese tamper actually ran away because it didn't have any brakes. So if you come up this end, Luke, we've now made or adapted one of a perma-quip standard gauge trolley, which is this, and it's now got a handbrake on it, as you can see, there, and brake rigging. So that is permanently coupled to the tamper with this bar, this jaw bar with the two pins in it, with linch pins in the bottom. So that means that the tamper is not going to roll away, because if the chain breaks, then it would be off. So there's also a seat. We've got this van vault on the back of the trailer, and there's a seat in there which slots in that square tube for the operator. So the operator's not actually on the tamper, and he's not getting all the vibration up through his feet. We're very pleased with it. They're two genuine Honda engines. The only thing we might like to do is the tines, which is the little spade things, are a little bit far away from the rail, so we may heat them up and bend them a bit closer to the rail. But that's what we've had to do to it, because they are quite rare for a narrow gauge railway. A lot of narrow gauge railways, of course, need to do tamping, and if you haven't got the machine, you've got to do it by hand, which is very very labour intensive.
By far the warmest place in Pendray on a cold day is the paint shop, which
and my office
and your office. Well, okay, we're not going in there. This is more interesting.
Yeah.
And in the paint shop, is our new open carriage, which is progressing steadily.
Yep.
And I think we'll see a quite a large transformation since the last time we saw it. You can see there's the Andy's done a fantastic job of varnishing the roof inside and put the rubberized coating on the top. So that's all done, isn't it, really?
Yeah, we've just got the ends to do.
Yep. And then the big change will be when these lovely panels, which have all been painted absolutely fantastically, get bolted on, and it'll really begin to look like an open carriage then, won't it?
Certainly will, yeah.
The ends are going to be
glazed.
Yeah. So it really will feel very airy and open when we get there.
Yep.
And then Martin's been making some...
These are the doors.
Doors to go on.
These are going to be full height doors. And we've got the locks. So this is the first one that's been painted. And we're going to do it very thoroughly because it's steel and it's going to live outside. Well, it's going to live in the carriage here, but obviously running trains, it's going to get wet regularly.
Yeah. And then the base that it sits on is being progressed. So realistically, by the start of next main season, we should have a lovely new open carriage.
Well, we've got the brake gear to do on the frame. The frame is built and the wheel sets are to hand.
Yeah.
The axle boxes have been machined and Graham's over there. He just finished painting them this morning.
Okay.
So they can be assembled onto the wheel sets. We've got to make the brake gear, as I say, get the underframe round here, paint that, put the body on. So there's a bit to do, but we're well on with
it now. It's progressing now. Yeah, it's starting to look like
it's taken a long time to paint all the panels, but there are 3, 6, 9, 18, 24 of them.
And how many coats do they have? Something ridiculous.
They had quite a lot of coats. Yeah.
Quite a lot
of coats.
Says the man.
I can't tell off the top.
About 6, wasn't it? Something like that.
Primer undercoat, top
what's
coat,
this,
varnish.
What's this grey thing in here then,
this
Chris?
Is an MOD box fan, which we use for putting our permanent way paraphernalia inside. It was hoofed out of the quarry shed to make room, so we thought we could house it in here for a little bit, but also give it a bit of a body overhaul. So it's had the doors repaired, and now it's having a repaint. We've done some work on the underframe, adjusted the brakes, and done the old safety inspection underneath. So it's just
maintained.
It's only the 1980s, I believe. It's not
really.
Not
and where did it come from before it came here then?
I don't know.
You don't know? Okay.
No. Martin.
Another informative historic segue from Mr. Smith.
Sorry about that. No. Perhaps Luke can find out and stick it over the top.
Yeah. Fine. Okay. That's right, the inside of the. And there's all these panels here and the top.
Loads of panels.
It really is ready to make a big difference. I'm quite excited about this.
Yeah, it's going to look good.
Yeah,
it's going to look good.
Right. Well, through the winter, we're doing a lot of. Planned maintenance, and in this case we're getting the engine ready for going out next weekend. Been several little jobs to do. First one is in the smoke box, where
don't fall down, y'all.
We've fitted a new drain pipe to this silencer, which intercepts the condensate coming out of the air pumps and saves it going up the chimney and all over our wonderful customers who support our hobby so much, or in my case hobby, in Chris's case his employment. So I've just fitted a new pipe in here which drains the water out and it passes down in front of the cylinder through the frame stiffening plate and out down onto the track. And while the cover plate's off, I've taken the opportunity to get some grease on the front draw hook, which is otherwise inaccessible.
Brilliant. That's great.
Right.
Pickling.
Pickling.
About pickling.
Another job we do fairly regularly is attend to the injectors here, which feed water into the boiler. I haven't actually got one dismantled at the moment for cleaning in our pickle bath, which is a solution of citric acid to remove the furring. But what I have got is the sectioned one that we use for training purposes. And you can see here how intricate the passages are and how, if they fur up, the efficiency drops off. Steam is injected in at this end, combines with water from the tank there and then feeds through these other cones to generate a significantly higher pressure than boiler pressure to feed the water into the boiler to make up what we've boiled off as steam to drive the engine.
Brilliant. So we had some, we've had failures in the past where the injector won't work. We've taken them off overnight, pickled them, put them back on the next day, and that's brilliant. It's fixed the problem. But what Chris is with David Jones is attempting to do here is pickle them before they actually give us a problem and just keep them clean. And that's done every B exam, I believe.
Well, it's done when the engine's out of traffic for a short period as a preventative measure. It's a lot easier to grab one off and deal with it preventatively than have a crew have difficulty up the line.
That's brilliant. And gauge glasses.
Right,
gauge. Very important. A little piece of tube that only costs about £15, but very important. It's attached to the back of the boiler. It's got the boiler pressure inside it. If you're very unlucky, or it's in poor condition, they will burst, and then the cab is full of steam, and that's a major problem. So what do we do to prevent that? And what have you got any old ones we could show?
Right, yeah. Well, again, a preventative maintenance. We have to take the protector off. Well, let's isolate the gauge. There's no pressure. Protector comes off there, and probably see more clearly now. The water level shows up in the glass there, but the steam erodes the glass, particularly at the top, and I've got a couple of ones that came out. You see how that's necked at the end there? You might see it better on the shadow, actually.
Yeah, the end's reduced, isn't it, where the steam's actually cut the glass away.
Yeah, I mean, that's the bottom end. This is a top end. And again, see whether you can possibly see it better on the shadow.
So we've got to change this before it actually bursts.
Yeah.
And we do that on a planned basis.
So again, here is a new one with the appropriate rubbers that I use to seal into the nuts there. As against, there's an old rubber that's come out, deformed, gone hard, won't seal so well. In all my years on the footplate, I have only ever had one fail in traffic. And again, while we're doing that, we take these nuts off the end here and rod through the passages into the boiler to make sure that they're well and truly clean, so that we're not getting false levels showing in the gauge glass.
Brilliant. That's absolutely brilliant. Yeah, thanks, Zach. Uncle, that's super.
Right.
Yeah. Cheers, then.
You better go
not
and see...
Not my uncle, but he is an uncle.
Yeah, you better go and see my nephew now, because he's here.
We could do. That's continuity, that, isn't it? So we've just met Uncle, and the reason he's an uncle is here's his nephew. This is Ed. What's Ed up to? Ed's working on Loco 2, some bits for Loco 2 today. So we've got one of the valve spindles, which is up in the lathe, and found quite a lot of wear on it, didn't you, Ed?
We have. A lot of scoring on the top, I don't know if you can see that on there.
Probably zoom in, yeah. So this works backwards and forwards into the valve chest, and that portion of it is worn away.
Yeah, that's where the gland and the follower is. That's where it's took all the wear.
So how are you going to fix it?
I've got it clocked up true, both ends. We're going to take a skim down this. I've already done the other side this morning. We'll restore that to a constant diameter from one end to the other, polish it up to a high surface finish so it doesn't damage the new gland packing material when we put it back together.
Brilliant. Cheers, Ed. Thanks for that. Yep.
Okay, we're back in the main workshops now, and I'm no engineer, but I'd say that that was kind of back to bare basics.
Yep, there's not much
more.
What
have you done?
The team of volunteers with a few staff have dismantled it down to this stage. So the wheels are out now, the motion's all gone, the valve spindles and the valves are out. We've opened up the valve covers, and the tank's been taken off, and the well tank below underneath, that's come off as well. this is as far as we're going now. It doesn't not necessary to strip it any further. The wheel sets are going to have new crank pins fitted and new tyres. Sorry, not new tyres, new tyre turning. We're going to reprofile the tyres. New tyres is a lot of money, which I don't really want to ask for. Because I'm frugal, you see.
Well done.
Yep. Axle boxes are down there as well. So, as I said, there's a lot of volunteer time has gone into dismantling this. It's been done quite carefully. Nothing's been broken or anything. So we're generally quite pleased with what we've found. There's an issue with a valve spindle where one of the keys has, isn't fitted that well. So we're going to rectify that. And that's about it, really. We've got some laser cuts here. These are for, I mean, hydraulic the boiler. Oh, we'll talk about the boiler, actually. We'll go and see the boiler in a sec. When you hydraulic a boiler, it hasn't got any of the fittings on it. So this will be drilled, and then you can bolt this on the boiler when you test it. The test actually is where you fill it to the brim with water, pump it up, and then just see if it leaks. So these are blanking plates, and these have all been laser cut by one of our members for us. Okay, we probably better go and see the boiler, hadn't we? This is the boiler for number two. This was built in Bridge North 10 years ago and a bit. And it's just had its annual inspection last week with Peter Hawkins, who's our boiler inspector, who we're very happy with. And it doesn't need, there's a couple of studs that need replacing, and that's it. We're very impressed with it. I think that's probably testament to the water treatment that it's had, and they've got the water treatment correct. There was a bit of sludge on the foundation ring, which is possibly because we've moved the blow-down valve to the side, so we can hose that out. And there's a tiny bit of corrosion on the back head where the, can't swear, can I? Where the debris is built up on the back plate. On the back end. But other than that, the boiler inspector was happy and he said, yeah, go ahead and tube it. So we've ordered the tubes. And the nice thing about narrow gauge is it's cheap compared to a standard gauge engine. He's grimacing at me here. A set of tubes was about 970 quid, which isn't a big deal, you know, I wouldn't have thought. So, yeah, there's the boiler. The volunteers have already painted the outside in the old aluminium heat-resistant paint. And the bottom half is black because you can see that through the pocket in the frames on the side. So the next stage is to, as I say, is to tube it. Once the tube's arrived, we can tube it. Then we can put those little blanking plates on that I showed you. And this is one of the locations where they would go. So normally there's a valve on there when the engine's complete. But we want to pump it up with water under pressure to check for leaks. So you fit the blanking plate over there. That's what those little plates are for. And we've got those to fit all the different little bosses on the boiler all over. And there's one for the regulator as well, which is in the smoke box. That's a D-shaped one that just goes where that little pink bit of cloth is. All right. So that's the boiler. Introduce you next to Neil Potts. Neil is a machinist who's just joined the staff a few weeks ago, and he's making parts for our screw couplings. These are some of the remains of a screw coupling which are no longer fit for use. They actually connect the carriages together as the train's moving up the railway. Very important, but the thread and the internal thread in there do wear out. We inspect them once a year and we record how much movement takes place, and then there's a pass-fail criteria, and some of them have failed it. So time's come to make new ones, or at least refurbish them with new nuts and fitted to the decent threads. And Neil's been working on that, so let's see what we can see with that, eh? So this is Neil. Neil's going to tell us a little bit about what he's been doing.
Yeah, we're making some replacement screw coupling nuts. As you can see, the thread is worn on the inside. So we start off with that as a component. And then when we got that component, we put it in the lathe. With a jig I've made, as you can see there.
So what's the jig do? Does that centralise the nut in the middle?
The jig centralises, save using the four-jaw chuck on the four points. It picks it up central to the bore. So we can put one in, take one out.
Brilliant. Put one in. So that'll save time then?
Yeah.
Yeah, good.
If you want to have a look at me running through the run.
Could do. Work. I'll stand back so I haven't got my glasses on. Safety glasses.
Cut off to a set size. backwards and reverse. Backwards and reverse. And that doesn't damage the thread on the inside.
Brilliant. Can I have a close up of the thread that he's just cut in the ball? That's... So that cuts the spiral shape of the actual thread.
Yeah.
Yeah. Brilliant.
It's
very good.
Square thread and there's 4 teeth per inch.
Quite.
Hopefully.
And you made your tooling to suit, didn't you?
Yes.
That's good. Nice one. Thanks a lot, Neil. That's interesting. Yeah, good stuff. Well, I'd like to introduce Carl George. Carl is a new fitter who has just joined the team and he's ex-chemical industry.
That's right.
Yep. Very pleased to have you here, of course. And Carl's got his work cut out. He's doing a B exam on this diesel locomotive and with a few repairs that become due. So we've hoofed out Loco 6 from the Loco shed in order to make room for it. And being here on the pit and raised up, hopefully it's not too bad environment.
Yep.
Yeah, can you just show us what you've been up to then?
Yeah, well, this is the B exam, so I've got a big check sheet to go through, but there was also a few running repairs to do as well. So there was reported a bad air leak underneath, so we've changed air regulator for the brakes. So after that, it was sandboxes. None of them worked, so that was freeing off the cylinders and unblocking the pipes. Then fuel filters and the drain, cleaned all that out, reprimed it. Yesterday we changed the water, make sure we've got a decent antifreeze mix in there. And today I'm measuring chains with the possibility of changing the chain in the future, which would be a nice greasy job.
Those are the drive chains, aren't they?
Yeah.
Yeah, right. Brilliant. That's great. Well, thanks for all the work you're doing. And it's very valuable stuff, this. The diesel's used most days. Well, there's 2 Bagleys, but they're used on the permanent way trains. And they can also rescue a passenger train if needed. So they're sort of unsung heroes, really. Essential machines. And it's good, while it's in the shed, to do as many jobs on it as we can, isn't it?
Brilliant. Yep.
Yeah, that's great. Thanks, Carl. Cheers,
okay,
mate. Yeah, brilliant.
Right, that concludes our look around the Pendray Works, and I'm pleased to see there's so much activity going on. I should be sacked. And new faces that we've caught up with.
Yeah, it was brilliant to have those 2 new staff members. They're good guys.
Lots of progress to keep us going. So I suppose the news is still that we are running trains every weekend, and they've been very well loaded, sort of the same loadings that we experienced in May. So if you have the need for a steam fix, I think we are the only steam railway working at the moment on weekends, and every weekend right the way through till 20th, I think it is, and then the Santa specials take over before Christmas, 22nd to 24th. They're booking up really well, so get in quick. And then what everybody needs after Christmas is a steam train ride, so we run the 26th Boxing Day right the way through to the 5th of January when the schools go back. So you can have a steam train ride and get out and explore the area and get some fresh air, which everybody needs after Christmas. So that's all good. Anything left for you to say, apart from?
Ask you what I'm getting for Christmas this year. Same as last year?
Yeah.
All right, okay.
A day off.
he's so good to me.
Very good.
That's okay. It. No, thanks a lot. Thanks for watching. If you've got any questions, email them in. Luke's going to put up details on the end of the film of where we got the Tamper from, because that's been a popular question for people to ask. So all the details will be on there of the firm in China that actually built it. Yep.
That's good night from him.
Good night from him, yep.